Hello everyone who is watching us on YouTube, Facebook and Contacting, and thank you so much for joining us tonight. My name is Larissa and I am executive producer at Strelka Institute. I'm really excited to be bringing back the second edition of our event series called In Other Worlds. Today, as part of our Strelka 2020 Live Public Program, we will talk about broken worlds and stories we will tell within them. Before we begin, I would like to thank our event partners, the United States Embassy in Moscow, for their support. The event will be held in English with simultaneous translation into Russian, so please follow Russian version in Strelka Kontakte, Strelka space page Kontakte, and on Facebook. We invite everyone to engage in the active discussion with us and post questions on YouTube, Facebook or Kontakte chat. We will monitor them and pass them to our speakers. And now I would like to introduce and thank Liam Young, who made this amazing event possible by creating and directing Another World series. Liam is a film director and speculative architect who operates in the spaces between design, fiction and futures and builds imaginary worlds for the film and television industry. His works have been exhibited widely across the world and he has been teaching in institutions like AA School, Princeton, and now runs the fiction and entertainment program in SciArc in Los Angeles and is visiting faculty at Strelka Institute. Tonight, Liam will be joined by Mike Winkelmann, AA BEEPLE, who will be creating one of his iconic everyday pieces with us. Joel Collins, production designer of Charles Brooker's Black Mirror and costume designer for film and television and Crabtree. Thank you so much once again for tuning in. And now, off to you, Liam.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to day one of 2020's edition of In Other Worlds. Design fictions as a way of coming to terms with conditions that reality struggles to grasp. In films, games, and television, we've always imagined alternative worlds as a way of understanding our own world in new ways. Across two evenings, In Other Worlds brings together an ensemble of directors, concept artists, animators, and storytellers for an expedition through an atlas of imaginary worlds, fictional cities, and speculative geographies. As our lives are collapsing around us, we will listen to stories of broken futures and narratives of possible escape. 1816 is known as the year without summer, as the eruption of Mount Tambora in Indonesia caused an average global temperature decrease by up to 0.7 degrees. And famously, to wait out the cold in Byron's Lake Geneva villa, the Shelleys and Polidori would create modern literature's most iconic horror stories. And 2020 somehow is the year without outside. It's the year without places, without crowds, without the public. It's the year without end. So in a similar moment of darkness, we explore the dystopian tales of our time. As the cities we all inhabit begin to resemble a live-action dystopian film playing out in real time, we're going to reevaluate the relevance of this genre of broken worlds. The terrifyingly arresting images of environmental disaster, alien invasions, post-apocalyptic wastelands, global war zones, and economic ruin are all caricatures of a future that is systematically being stolen away from us. In a climate of madness, what can we learn from these broken worlds? What are the alternative stories that we can tell within them? How else could we use them? What encounters could we have and what new experiences can we generate? What are the possibilities of a productive dystopia? So for day one of In Other Worlds, we'll be joined by designers of some of our iconic dystopian visions to explore the cautionary tales that may help us to find a way forward or warn us against digging a deeper hole. To chronicle the broken worlds of our everyday, we meet Mike Winkelmann, aka BEEPLE, a prolific artist that for almost 5,000 consecutive days has been creating an original image or animation. An adventure through his past decade of everydays is a cross-section through the zeitgeist, a grotesque serialization of the present moment. And as we look back through the archive, we glimpse the industrial milking of Mickey Mouse, a zombie Mark Zuckerberg, and more recently a demonic Donald Trump mainlining Lysol, stumping on civility, and suckling at Kim Jong-un's cyborg teat. Mike is going to take us through the creation of August 11th's Every Day, a live window into the construction of a new world.
Sorry. Hi. Suckling at Doctor's teeth. Yeah. I'm sorry. That intro, that was the greatest intro. It's funny because you're saying these things so dark and serious, and they're so stupid. That was great. That made my day.
Yeah. Oh, I'm for hire, Mike. I can be your speechwriter. We can go on tour.
It's just funny hearing the things like actually like articulated what they actually are. It's like, oh god, that's what it is.
Well, I can't think of a better way to start a discussion about broken worlds and dystopias than in hilarious laughter.
I don't know what else you can do at this point. I'm not sure what else there is. Like, I think we're at the point where it's just like,
it is what it is, as Donald Trump has called the coronavirus disastrous.
Oh my god, this is, yeah.
So here we are. So thanks for joining us, Mike, across
thanks
the
for
universe.
Having me.
And as everyone can see now, we're peering into Mike's Cinema 4D landscape. And for the next 30 or 40 minutes, we're going to be peering over his shoulder while he makes one of his everyday images in a form of kind of concept illustration, improv comedy. Mike is pretty serious about audience participation. So he's calling for art direction across the chat window. So for everyone tuning in and watching, hello, and please make suggestions for the direction that that Mike could take this every day. So where do you want to start, man? Normally dive in here?
Yeah, so just to kind of like give people sort of just like a very super brief overview, because we only have, you know, a half hour or so of what my workflow is. I'm making these pictures every day for a number of years. And the way that I work now, and my workflow has sort of evolved over the years, but the biggest piece of it is this Cinema 4D, which is a 3D program where you can like animate 3D models and light things. And basically, so I put together scenes using this 3D thing, and then I kind of take it into Photoshop, do some post work, but that's the overall sort of like high level workflow. And the way that I work now is mainly sort of like bringing in 3D models, which I get mostly from Turbo Squid. They've got like just tons of awesome 3D models. Kitbash 3D, there's tons of places out there. And sort of it's kind of like playing with toys at this point, that I've got all of these different things and I can bring them in. I can just, you know, click twice and then I've got a camel in there. And so I can, you know, do this and okay, here's two camels, like, you know, doing whatever camels do. So it's very quick to just be able to like take and play with these things and kind of like go from there. So it's a very, it just feels like a very fun sort of like dynamic workflow. And I can see the tools have gotten to a point where I can see like pretty much immediately what it's going to look like. So I can take here and I've got a camel and I've got a bunch of all different things. So here's a camel and I can throw in a desert object. And so now you've got, you know, within, throw in a sky. So now within, you know, how many seconds was that? 15 seconds. We've got, you know, a camel in the desert and we can like go from there. So it's very able to like sort of like iterate on things and get to a finished piece quite quickly because the technology has gotten to a point that you can do all of these things and there are all these assets and there's all these materials and all this stuff. So that's usually what I do. I sort of like take the things and this also allows me to sort of like make things very quickly based on the news, which is kind of what I've been doing lately is sort of like looking and I watch a lot of like news and read a lot about the news. And so a lot of times I'm able to sort of like react to what happened that day or the day before, like, and put out like a finished piece because of the sort of like workflow that I, you know, sort of use. So we've got all different, you know, people here, all different types of people, workers, robots, a bunch of different, you know, cartoon people I use a lot, a bunch of different celebrities that I use a lot. And then all different, you know, buildings, all different food, all different animals, and then a bunch of sort of like robot pieces and stuff that I can use to like build different things as well. So there's all different pieces and I can just click and like bring it in. So that's kind of like how I put these pictures together, which a lot of people I think, you know, don't kind of understand a lot. Because I think this is a fairly like new workflow. Like this wasn't something like even 10 years ago because there weren't all of these things. It would be very hard to like do something like this. Okay, Liam, what are we doing today?
Well, what were in the headlines? I'm fascinated in the reason I wanted to bring you in today was the way that your art responds to the present moment, you know, and when we're living in a live action dystopia, in a way that these everydays become a kind of running commentary. So sure. before we went live, we were talking a little bit about that our hosts in Russia have cracked the coronavirus today, apparently, and the vaccine is out. Putin's daughter had been vaccinated. So I thought we might do a coronavirus themed.
Okay, what if we do something? We've got the coronavirus right there. Boom, and we're in. So what if we did something with some sort of vaccine type thing where people are building a vaccine or how they're coming up with this vaccine maybe?
That sounds cool. So you're thinking virus / lab.
Yeah, we could do that. We could do something that's, So what do we got? Let's see. Is there any suggestions in the chat here for virus lab?
We've got a question from the chat, no suggestions. If anyone out there in the interwebs want to put through suggestions, just to reiterate, definitely go through and discuss. I feel like there's lab, but I'm wondering if there's also lines of people waiting to be vaccinated or something, or if there's like crowds pleading and baying for waiting for the vaccine, or maybe there's some figure in the background about to buy the world supply so no one can get it or something.
That seems like probably a thing. What if we did? What if we had? Okay, so we'll probably need some hazmat people here.
Yeah, they can be. They can be dishing out the vaccine potentially to the rich elites or the lucky few.
We could win the coronavirus lottery.
Yeah,
we could do that. I feel like there's probably a good chance the first people to get it will be the richest people. So what if we had Mark Zuckerberg? He seems like he's always a fun guy.
Yeah, he's made some cash. Do you have a Jeff Bezos face as well?
I do not have a Jeff Bezos. Elon,
let's bring Elon in. I mean, let's bring in the billionaires that have made. I think
Kanye apparently is now a self-proclaimed billionaire.
Oh, right. Okay. Well, he's going to be
in. So we'll throw him in there, I guess. Can't hurt.
I think let's bring in the profiteers of the latest apocalypse. I think in the 2 hours that we're going to be online, Jeff Bezos will have made $18 million. And I think Zuck is up in that territory as well. So
I'm sure they've got
the spare change to pay for a virus. We do have some comments coming in on the chat. A lot of suggestions. 5G delivery of the vaccine. Feel free to grab any of these out of the ether, Mike. Lab floating in space. Penguin eggs. I'm not sure the penguin reference, but that's intriguing. The virus is part of a speaker system powering out noise over a crowd of hazmat suits. Are these the sort of virus in the sky like a comet, virus vectored by an insect? Trump stealing the vaccine from Russia so that he invented it first. Oh, that's solid.
Okay, let's do... So let me get this a little bit more of a... looking like a lab.
A special delivery from Olga, one of the organizers at Strelka, is calling for Keanu Reeves in the line. I'm not sure. I feel like he'd be waiting at the back, letting people go through. He's quite a charmer.
Maybe that should be it. Since everybody is like, Keanu Reeves is such a nice guy, maybe this is like Keanu Reeves is giving out maybe this is a good... Instead of going like super evil with it, we go good, and Keanu Reeves is like generously giving out the vaccine.
All right, or he's like the bouncer at the club, and actually he's really a bastard.
Everybody's freaking.
Yeah, but yeah, maybe it's maybe in the context of the show we do an optimistic turn and. Vaccines for all, and the glorious Keanu Reeves is doling it out. Maybe that's the direction.
What?
And the billionaires are at the back of the line.
He's put the billionaires to the back of the line. Where is that Keanu Reeves? Okay, so I don't know if this Keanu is rigged. We're going to see. No, it is not. So we might have to just cut his head off and put it on another body. And so that's kind of the fun part about sort of like working like this is you're able to kind of take sort of like pieces off of things and kind of like mishmash between different bodies, different sort of like heads, different whatever.
It's fascinating just to peer into the process. I mean, I was going to try and draw you out a little bit on a conversation, but if I'm distracting you,
no, I'm good. I'm good.
Feel free to ignore me.
What's going on? I mean, you're in LA right now?
I'm in LA, front row seats for the American apocalypse. We've gone back into lockdown. And I guess that's what I wanted to talk about a little bit. I mean, one of my daily routines is waking up and checking in on the Beeples every day. It's almost like checking the headlines. I'm interested in it because famously South Park, they also work on a pretty insane timeline. They produce an episode from start to finish in just 6 days. And this insane production schedule means that the show is able to remain timely and relevant in a way that other animations just can't.
Has South Park always done that? Because I just heard somebody talking about that, and I guess I didn't realize that. Like, is that how it's always been?
Always, yeah.
Wow, yeah. I did not know that. That's crazy.
I mean, maybe not in series one when they were just like, you know, figuring stuff out. But once they got rolling, yeah, six days start to finish. In context, like normally a 30-minute animated show is a like, you know, a 3 to 10 month timeline. So it's extraordinary. But that timeline means that they can respond to the immediacy of the news cycle. They stay sharp. They stay incisive. I mean, it means that some of the shows don't age very well because they're very much of the moment in which they're made.
Sure. And to be honest, that's what kind of like stopped me for the longest time from like wanting to do anything that was too sort of like, you know, frozen in a moment. And you'd look back and like, you know, how many years later it'd be like, I don't even know what the hell this is about. Like, people won't even know. But then it's sort of like, I don't know. I feel like for right now, I don't know. I guess I don't put too much thought into like how things will age, I guess.
But I guess they're also like, you know, I don't think we judge them based on their longevity or the archive, the cultural archive that they create, but more so, their documents of the moment in which they were made, a cross section of this slice through time. And I think that's one of the amazing functions of the everyday, is that it can actually do that, be this kind of diary of either your own inner thoughts or whatever it is you caught across the airwaves, kind of mainlining CNN or Fox News into your room there in Wisconsin. So, I think that's why it's interesting in a way. And sometimes I guess you're just doing experiments and cool looking shit, but also sometimes Donald Trump is injecting Lysol and it's useful to have that strangeness reflected back to us in your images. I mean, is that how are you kind of sourcing this content sometimes? Like, you are just like soaking up the headlines like the rest of us and something pops out and you need to respond?
Pretty much. Like, I read a lot of news, and I've got, I don't know if you can see in the background, I've got two TVs in my office that are on all day. One is set to CNN and the other is set to Fox News, and they're on mute, but they're on all day. And so there's kind of this like constant like influx of news into, you know, sort of my room. So it's kind of inescapable. And this was like, to be honest, I really only started doing sort of more political, very like topical things like a year ago. It's not like for, you know, the last 13 years I've been doing this. It's been quite recent, actually. So I think it's one of these things where, you know, this right now feels interesting. I mean, whether I'm going to be doing something like this, you know, 2 years from now or whatever, who knows? To be honest, I feel like I like sort of get tired of a theme pretty quickly, like a way of working, and I'll like move on to something else fairly fast. So, I mean, who knows? For now, this is, you know, interesting to me. I'm going to go ahead and save it. But I don't know if, like, you know, down the line, this will be sort of the way that I work or the topic that I'm, you know, sort of creating.
But it just seemed like something you just naturally started to move into just because the context around you was so pervasive.
To be honest, I've never really thought like that much about, and I think because I have to come up with something every day, I'm not sort of like thinking like, okay, I'm going to sort of like change the like where this is going over the course of the next, you know, 3 months or whatever. It's literally just like, okay, what picture can I get like excited about making like today? And like, that's pretty much it. Like, there's not like a bunch of thought of like, okay, where is this going? How does this fit into the like bigger sort of like, you know, picture of this everyday's project? It's literally just like, okay, what can I possibly do to like, you know, make something today that's not embarrassing or is less embarrassing than, you know, yesterday. So it's not something where it's like super, super planned out. Like, I have no idea what I'm going to do. Obviously, I had no idea what I was going to do today. I don't know about these Tasman people. And it's very much a, you know, every day is just kind of like a mad scramble to make anything that's not like a total pile of crap.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure you definitely don't dwell too long on content, and in many ways you can't. But looking back this year, there's definitely a series of preoccupations that emerge. And I'm not trying I'm not trying to like frame this in any, like, you're not solving the world's problems, but you're definitely seem.
I hope definitely seemed waiting. You definitely solve problems,
but you definitely seem to enjoy poking them with a stick in a way, right? And just kind of giving them a nudge to see how they respond, which I think is kind of interesting.
I mean, I think I've always had kind of like a dark sort of like sense of humor, and like I've always kind of, I think, wanted to do like things that were, I feel like now the tools have gotten to a point where I can do like, I can kind of like do more what I want without the tools kind of like getting in the way, which I feel like wasn't the case in the past. The technology was sort of like not there to allow me to just be able to do like literally kind of like whatever I wanted. So I definitely feel fortunate that it's gotten to a place where it's like you can, you know, kind of quickly realize ridiculous ideas to some fidelity level, I guess.
I'm just scanning the chat. There's one note. Is it an issue that the virus behind us looks unvaccinated? Like, and you get some vaccine vibe in there that Keanu is holding up the virus itself. Is there something that we can do?
That's true. I'm going to go ahead and throw that back at that person. I agree. It kind of looks like he's brought the virus.
Yes.
So maybe, what can I do to make it look like he's the one actually curing the virus instead of causing it? Put this white suit on. I feel like that's a little, or then does he not read as Keanu then?
We can try that. I mean, maybe there's some vaccine assets or something. Maybe is that too literal? Or we have some antibodies somewhere inserted into the frame. Or a stockpile of vaccines behind us or being injected into the virus itself, potentially.
We could maybe do, trying to think how to show that. I definitely have some. What if we had, we could do a, trying to think of like a Keanu, some sort of injection. I don't know if I have a, a like needle, trying to think, medical, no, what if we had, what if the this just was like, this virus was everywhere, and he's like, yeah, maybe he's not holding up the
it's not holding up the actual thing, but maybe there are like the bodies of dead viruses scattered around him. One suggestion from the chat was kind of light emission from inside the virus, this kind of Akira anime style explosion that suggests it's on the verge of death, was one proposal. Or the landscape of viral corpses also, because we've defeated it, seems like one way to go. I wonder,
maybe we'll put people standing.
A lot of the conversations that you've had tend to focus in on this model of production and the sheer effort in making it every day. There's one, maybe we can cover that as well a little bit. One question on the chat is what pushes you to do it? And you've spoken a bit about, with brutal honesty, about deadlines, and that really this is an attempt to try to trick yourself into making work, and without the self-imposed deadline of an every day, you might not just get around to doing anything at all. I wonder if you can talk a little bit about the drive to do it.
I mean, I think the biggest drive to do it is just wanting to get better and really like trying. Like when I'm looking at this picture right now, it is just fully a pile of trash. And so it's like, okay, this is, I need to get much, much better, because this is just fully butt trash right now. And so not wanting to make butt trash is probably the biggest motivating factor. Creating less butt trash, I would say, is the overwhelming motivation.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense.
I get it.
No, I get it. I definitely get it. You should definitely continue to try to make less butt trash.
I see the trajectory as well across the last 13 years and 4,800 some images. Do you think they are getting better? Are they evolving? I mean, so we've spoken about how content has shifted this year, some of your new work is moving into territories of AR and VR, and you spoke a little bit about the tools being new. Are there constantly evolutions? You might want to move into real time. Are there things that are pushing the technical evolution of the everydays that you want to keep on exploring and testing? Is that part of it as well?
Yeah, I think that's part of it. I think, to be honest, like, I don't think technically there's that much holding me back. And I think that sometimes that's like can be somewhat of a crutch or somewhat of a fixation, that people fixate a bit more on the like technical tools when really they should be a little bit more focused on just like the fundamentals of like image creation. Like I, at this point, like the tools are pretty ridiculous. like the fact that I'm able to sort of like make and see the finished image of this like almost immediately and be able to sort of like iterate on it very, very quickly. I think the tools are always going to get like, you know, stronger and more advanced, but I think it's already in a place where you can create some like crazy, crazy crap. So to me, I'm mostly interested in like I feel like I'm the bottleneck, not the tools. I don't feel like it's like, oh man, if I only had XYZ tools. It's more like, oh man, I have like the most amazing tools and my pictures still like fucking suck. Like that's not the tools anymore. That's me. So I feel like I'm mostly interested in, you know, getting better at composition, getting better at sort of storytelling, getting better at values, getting better at, you know, just overall, I don't know, just making better pictures, for lack of a better, to lack of a more eloquent term.
Yeah. I mean, how much are you trying to, I mean, humor is so much both a part of the work, but also a part of, the self-deprecating way that you talk about it. How much are you trying to make something funny versus something meaningful, I guess? I mean, you can obviously do both, but do you care about one and not the other? In many ways, sometimes it's the absurdity of what you do that's required for us to be able to step outside our own reality and look back in on it to see how weird and strange and sometimes terrifying things really are. A lot of the times the horrors of the world are just hiding in plain sight, and it takes someone like you or humor and satire in order to draw that out. I mean, are you conscious of that role of humor in the work?
I am and I'm not. Like, I'm not trying to like make things funny. I'm actually usually trying to make something like that's more on the like serious side than like, to a degree, I guess it's not always like super that I'm trying to make something. Obviously with this Keanu Reeves thing, I think it's a mix of, I'm usually trying to make something that could be serious, but then if you like look back, it is like more ridiculous, that it's a little bit more subtle. Like, yeah, I could just like, okay, Keanu Reeves has like this thing and the fucking virus is his freaking boner. And it's like, you know, that's the thing. Like it could go, and sometimes it does go in that direction, and, you know, and now I feel like it did go in that direction. And now that I'm seeing that, now I actually do kind of like that. So I feel like it's a lot of times it's like, I'll take and try and make it more serious, and then like I'll get some idea like this, and then it'll spiral. Sometimes it kind of spirals a little out of control. And sometimes it's just like that, like a total accident, and then it's like, no, we're just gonna stick with that.
Another question from the chat, and I'm aware that I'm having this conversation about dystopias while we're staring at Keanu Reeves with a vaccine erection. Just try and stay on topic. One of the questions in the chat I think was interesting in relation to what we're talking about, where you can kind of watch the projection of science fiction across time that historically has been thinking about kind of far away and distant futures beyond 2000s. And as we've kind of launched screaming into the new millennium, the contemporary science fiction of the day, and we're going to hear about that later on, just after you, when we talk to Joel Collins, the production designer of Black Mirror, the contemporary science fiction of the day seems to be much more engineered around the present moment and a reframing of the present, almost what Ballard would describe as a visionary present. So not a distant future, but actually a strange look back in on a moment today with the the volume of certain aspects of that moment turned up to 11. And I mean, is that something that you're seeing in your own work? Maybe in the progression of the everydays, there were a lot of sci-fi environments that you began with, starry spaceship skies and more traditional concept art as we might know it. But now, yeah, it's taken on much more of a Black Mirror tone.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I super love Black Mirror, and like, I think it's like, I'm, you know, super excited to hear that talk. And Handmaid still too. I actually just started watching that, like, just very recently. And to be quite honest, it was like so, I feel like I'm not even sure I can watch it right now, because it's just so like, some of this shit hits so close to home, because it's just like, Jesus Christ, things are so fucked up right now. Like, but yeah, I think usually I'm trying to kind of, there's some element of truth in the things that I'm showing. Like, it's, there's, you can definitely see where that came from. And usually, I mean, there's so many like just crazy apocalyptic things happening on like a daily basis that it's not hard to like pull some, you know, kind of inspiration from the headlines now, because like every day it's just like, okay, now this happened. It's like that volcano erupting. Like, that was like a huge thing, and it's like barely on the news at all. It's like, okay, like any other time this would be like, oh my god, this like volcano erupted and like here's the aftermath of that. But it's just like, between that, the Lebanon thing, the coronavirus, the election, it's just like there's so much crazy shit happening like so rapidly. Like, there's just no break to like process any of this stuff. Like, it's just like an absolute onslaught of just crazy shit.
Yeah. I mean, is it hard to, in previous interviews, you've described yourself as being cautiously optimistic about technology. Is it hard to be optimistic in this moment? And in turn, I guess, is it also hard to create imagery and work that has at its core something aspirational or positive as a message? Is that why we are constantly being bombarded with revivals of cyberpunk dystopias and stories like Black Mirror, like Handmaid's Tale, still have such traction?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I would say I definitely find it a bit harder. Like, I think, you know, I don't know how you could not be like somewhat affected by the just like insane crap going on right now. But yeah, I definitely find it a bit harder to find a sort of like positive, hopeful spin on some of the things happening. I think it's definitely tough. To be honest, it's not, I don't usually, unless I've done like, I feel like it kind of like goes in waves. Like, I'll do like, you know, maybe two or three days of shit that's pretty dark and crazy, and then I'll kind of like need a break where it's like, okay, I'm gonna like balance this out with, you know, something not so freaking just dark as shit. I think I kind of somewhat self-regulate, I guess, kind of just based on my own, I don't know, where my head is at that day. I think it's definitely, I don't know, it's harder and harder, I feel like, to put a positive spin on things, kind of. I don't know, what do you think?
Well, definitely. I mean, I think there's the theme throughout the today's session is going to be productive dystopias, and I don't think the making of these kind of images is just about dwelling and relishing the darkness of the world as it stands, but actually there's something cathartic in that process of you know, finding story and narrative, and sometimes, especially in your work, humor in a reality that often feels very much emptied of that kind of lightness. So I think, yeah, that's why it was great to see you start to put together this image today. We're almost at time, but I want to thank you for taking us through the production of August 11th every day. I wonder if you're going to keep on working on it. Potentially, we could check back in with you at the end of the session and see a final image, or are you almost done and this is going to be dropped onto Twitter in no time?
Unfortunately, I can't, but I will definitely obviously finish it before the end of the day, and then you know, we'll be able to see. But yeah, I'll keep sort of this direction, Keanu savior direction, and then yeah, we'll see in probably a few hours. I should be able to, like, you know, kind of have it done, or it might be a little longer than a few hours because I unfortunately have some other stuff I have to do. But yeah,
so by midnight Wisconsin time,
this Eastern image time, it will definitely
Eastern
be
time.
So I'm not sure what time it is in Russia right now, but it will definitely be done in the next 11 hours. I can tell you that.
Fantastic. Okay, well, we'll check back in on Twitter, Instagram, Tumblr, wherever you get your daily dose of Mike Winkelmann / Beeple, and soon Keanu will save us all. and it's all going to be great. And I look forward to the next 5,000 images, Mike.
Awesome.
Thanks
Thank
so
you
much
for
joining us.
Super fun to chat.
That's great. Thanks, everyone, for participating, and thanks, Mike, for being a part of it.
Yeah,
fantastic. Sure. So we're going to move swiftly on, and we're going to visit with Joel Collins, production designer of Black Mirror, and talk about the extraordinary ways that Black Mirror, as the title suggests, and as we've been talking about with Mike, becomes a mirror to the ways that technology is increasingly changing our lives, spaces, and cities. Thanks, Mike.
Ideology rarely evolves at the same pace as our technology. The future does not rush over us like water. It is something we must actively shape and define, and stories from Charlie Brooker's Black Mirror series have encouraged us to start asking more questions of the technologies that are beginning to define our lives, spaces, and cities. Production is often just a side effect of science fiction, but again and again the series has become a roadmap for a tech industry intent on turning the world into its own Black Mirror episode. Joel Collins has been the series designer for the first four seasons and has shaped the tone and look of a world that is almost here, an all too real exaggeration of the present moment.
Thanks so much for joining us. In other words, Joel Collins, it's a pleasure to be speaking with you all the way across the Zoomscape.
Lovely to meet you, Liam, and everyone there, and I'm looking forward to what seems to be possibly a deep dive into the kind of past, my past in the world of Black Mirror.
Fantastic. Yeah, I mean, let's start there. Obviously, the theme for tonight's event is broken worlds, and in many ways, Black Mirror has become not just an icon of the dystopian genre, but no longer just a TV show. It has in many ways become an adjective for the increasingly frequent moments when technology takes a turn for the surreal or the sinister. So after the launch of the latest Apple iWhatever, we're often left asking, that feels a bit Black Mirror, doesn't it? And there's this, I think it's because there's this consistency to the Black Mirror psychological universe. And although it's an anthology of stories, each one feels like they are part of the same shared world. And along with showrunner Charlie and Annabelle, obviously, you've been this consistent design voice there on the project for a year before it even began, and across the first 19 episodes where the DNA of that show was formed. Can you talk a bit about this, the consistent anchors of the Black Mirror world, what defines something and a story as being Black Mirror?
Well, I think the beginnings of it are really, really simple. Black Mirror being my dog, but Black Mirror being the a phone, a Black Mirror looking back at you. You know, you look at your phone, you see your reflection, technology. And the idea of an anthology, a kind of digital twilight zone or a twilight zone for the digital era. It was an interesting prospect. And the early ideas were less about any correlation, I think, in the story initially, in the visual development. It was more about the kind of the story details. So it was always a slight exploration of our experiences with technology, and also ultimately it was always a kind of a bit of a warning to us that this was round the corner, or this was right here now, or this was slightly further than round the corner, but whichever way, if we don't play our cards right, this stuff will happen or could happen. And so interestingly, visually, one of the things I was eager to do was never really overplay anything in Black Mirror. It's easy to say when you look at some of it because it's quite heightened. But when you can do anything with a story, I wanted to do as little as we should do, making each episode and each film, each Black Mirror film, about that moment, those characters, that insular thing that was happening, and never overriding it through design or through kind of fantastical elements. So one of the kind of things I put to it, which was from early days, which was just because you can doesn't mean you should. And that means when you've got some script that says it could be 10 years, 20 years in the future, what's it like? I immediately went, nothing's really changed. The change is in this micro detail and it's not in the big picture. And that was the beginnings of what Black Mirror was, which was quite a grounded show in the way it feels and looks.
Yeah, and you've spoken of it as a kind of in-betweenness, I suppose, a world we know but we've never seen before. And in many ways, the world of Black Mirror, as you say, is already here, but it's kind of like just turning the volume up to 11 on one particular aspect of that world. So the space between the present moment and those of the show is so small. I think one of the reasons why it's gained traction in popular culture and also within the discussions and dialogue within the tech industry is because that in-betweenness means it's so easy to see the incidental or incremental developments that a technology could take to create a wholly dangerous reality. You know, in a way, we're already surrounded by this tech dystopia of Black Mirror. It's just hiding in plain sight, just an update away, creeping into our lives like a Trojan horse, kind of built plank by plank in a way.
But the Trojan horse is exactly right, because the horse isn't the problem, it's the people within it. And the tech isn't the problem, it's the people using it. And that's the simple baseline of Black Mirror, which is why it's effective and I think upsetting and disturbing and makes people question, is because it's not about what tech might do to us, it's what we're going to do to us. And it's about how we handle things. So, there's a lot of restraint needed when kind of exploring that, because, you know, you want to shout, scream and like, oh, my God, look what this tech can do. But it's never the tech. It's always the people.
Hmm. So how do you go about making those design decisions then and pulling back? I mean, so much of what we think of as the aesthetics of the future is steeped in cliche. But right now we're seeing an image on the screen from the episode, The History of You, where there is this interface where you can record everything about our daily life, which obviously seems to play on the impossibility of forgetting that exists within contemporary social media. And this screenshot that we see here from the interface within the story seems to mirror in an extraordinary way that of the interface of Google Glass, ripped out of reality from the same moment in which the show was created. Or even we're seeing a screenshot here from White Christmas, where just the simple idea of taking a function from present-day social media, like blocking someone, just ripped out of the screen and turned into real life, becomes extraordinarily torturous and terrifying. And you know, here Metalhead, which seems to somehow connect to Amazon's Spot Mini. I don't know if I'm making kind of drawing these conclusions as so many people have done before, but are you looking and reaching into the present moment for your design inspiration?
So if I wind back to entire history of you, an interesting experience, because Charlie, I discussed early on, that's season one of Black Mirror. So entire history of you, 2010, 2011. So it's almost 10 years ago we made that show. And Google Glass hadn't arrived, if I remember rightly, from my knowledge at that time. Nor had most of the apps that were about file sharing, storing of your own life. So I wanted to create an app in the eye and an environment in that episode, which was very sympathetic. I actually styled it a bit 50s, 60s, mid-century, but used it like we're in 2050, but I didn't go science fiction. So when you watch that episode, Entire History of You, you see something you identify. There's vintage cars, but they're electric. There's quite modern architecture. Could be international. It doesn't necessarily mean it's in England. And there's very earthy elements. There's metal, wood, stone. It's everywhere. And there's a willow grain. And there's the rings of the tree. So all your memories are stored on the rings of a tree. So your life is built like the rings of a tree in your memory bank. And I basically used nature and what we identify with and very natural elements to put the future in front of the audience. Didn't go all metal and glass and high tall buildings and computer science. In fact, grounded it with really natural elements behind each shot and in the frames. And then grounded it with something so you could see different rings. This has got a few rings and then people's memories that are slightly more fuller in this app have got more rings. And ultimately the willow grain and the rings of the tree, everything is brought to earth a bit. Everything is quite organic in its in design. And it's a way of making this very kind of integrated into the audience, so they kind of watch it and don't feel. Remember that in 2010 when we did this, it wasn't, you know, there's many apps that look like this now. There were none. This wasn't a rip-off of something we'd seen. This was something completely new and a way of explaining something. I remember a few years later going, oh my, look at these apps. They just look like the willow grain. They look like entire history of you. And so it's been an interesting journey. And I think with Charlie from that one episode, we talked and he said to me, imagine 5 years in the future or imagine 10 years in the future. You know, this was it. This was our early conversations. And like I said, I paired it back. So the further 40 years still felt quite familiar because, you know, you're looking at a very nuanced story in that one. And in fact, in most of the shows, most of the episodes. And you're looking at the fact that if somebody doesn't have this grain, everyone's very suspicious. You're looking at the fact that if you're not recording your memories, you might have something to hide. You're looking at, you know, world transport. So you could go to an airport, and if you've recorded every memory, you're able to travel wherever you want because clearly you haven't done anything dangerous. So you've got nothing to hide, and therefore you can travel at will. So at that point, these things were kind of science fiction, but have just pushed in 10 years to much more kind of a, you know, each Black Mirror we did got pushed quite quickly into a reality. So whether we were copying the current reality or whether we were just feeding on the kind of anxieties of what was next. And I think it was often more that. I mean, Boston Dynamics are a very interesting company. So with Metalhead, it was obvious that there was this quite sweet looking series of robots being created at Boston Dynamics. And in fact, it's like a mobile phone can do a lot of damage to people if used in the wrong way. We used inspiration from all sorts of robotics that were quite innocent seeming to explain where it could go. Designing a robot that wasn't to copy Boston Dynamics or any of these other robotics companies, but was to not be so far from where it could be in the sense of robotics in the next few years. And obviously with COVID, we've seen these robots walk, these dogs walking around, telling people to socially distance in countries. You know, it's very interesting. Couldn't have imagined that when we made Black Mirror, that would even happen. It was kind of a, oh my God, can you imagine a horror show if this could ever happen? And suddenly we're in COVID and these robot dogs are walking around telling you to socially distance, and it's only a few years before they're walking around shooting you if you don't. You know, it's like...
Yeah, I mean, how much of this is an act of prediction and coincidence, and how much of this do you think is about filmmakers and designers like you putting these diegetic prototypes into the world and gaining traction and currency with them, and then the world starts to follow? In many ways, prediction is just a side effect of science fiction sometimes, but it's actually much more instrumental in setting in motion the possibilities for the production of a certain reality than it is coincidentally getting it right at a certain point.
I think science fiction often wants to take a path that is bombastic, quite big, quite, you know, explosive, in the sense of look what the future holds. It's all going to be this, and it's crazy, and it's thousands of miles high, or it's, you know, there's a big vision. People want to bring their individual big vision to things in science fiction because they've got an opportunity to do it. And really, we had the responsibility to watch a chain of events that were at, say, this point. And they, you know, they'd gone from like here, we were at this point, we'd seen the chain of events, and it was just using imagination as to where it would get to by that point. So it wasn't like using our kind of ego, our, you know, big ideas to take it to the sky and beyond. It was incrementally moving it forward as where the reality might end, to kind of tell a story which is attainable to the audience and kind of a bit more horrific and a bit more unsettling because it's so close to reality. Obviously, because we were trying all the time to look at where things could go, would go, might go, given half a chance, because of that, it's a bit like predicting an event, or it's a bit like, you know, looking at the outcome of X, Y, and Z becomes that. And so obviously we ended up getting quite a lot of it close to realities, because we were trying to explore what those realities were. And I definitely don't think at Black Mirror, although it's kind of become a bit of a phrase for things, I don't think it's ever inspired anything. I think it's just, we were just always trying to assess, if you put your foot there, if you carried on in one line, where's it going to end? You know, it's we just followed the path intellectually to look at what the outcomes would be, which is what made interesting stories, I think.
Mm. Yeah, and of course, we're seeing here on the screen a shot of Waldo, the animated politician, and I can imagine that the horror of seeing the Trumpian reality that we all occupy, and so many people, not just I, and who are the maker of this meme, have drawn these relationships between Waldo and Trump, of course, and sometimes just following in those footsteps. And the frequency with which we seem to kind of treat Black Mirror almost like it almost becomes a blueprint for a tech industry intent on producing these realities is kind of shocking and disturbing in many ways.
I find Waldo interesting because Waldo was kind of quite an unpopular Black Mirror, but it was quite broad. It was silly in lots of ways. And so you go along with it for the ride that this ridiculous cartoon character could actually rise to power through popularity. And in fact, the audience, the Black Mirror audience, it was a mixed reaction. What's really interesting is how people have brought it back with Boris Johnson and Trump and actually big personalities becoming, you know, like almost cartoon characters becoming very, you know, high up in politics. And it again, it's hit that nail, but weirdly quite late. And it was so broad, I think, at the time that people were like, not sure, you know, because it was actually so silly that people couldn't think it could ever be real. And quite often the subtler, darker ones are the kind of more obvious kind of like, oh, is that real? My son, who's 16, watched a couple and actually thought, was that kind of a docudrama about a reality? And I went, this was when he was a bit younger. I was like, no, it's not real. But absolutely thought that some of them could have been real in the sense of how dark they are. Something like Shut Up and Dance could be a horrific reality.
Yeah. And I wonder if you can talk a little bit about, I guess it's that process of restraint or incremental change that has meant that the aesthetic of the future in Black Mirror has become so iconic and stands in such contrast to most science fiction that we see, where I just wonder why we're still repeating the 80s tropes of cyberpunk when the economic pendulum has long since shifted away from Japan, yet we still think of the future as this thing that's bathed in neon, reflecting off rain-soaked streets. I mean, here we're seeing some screenshots from Nosedive. The use of color, the restrained design palette, again, stands so different to what we've come to expect of our science fiction. Can you talk a bit about the avoidance of cliche in those terms?
Well, what was really interesting on Black Mirror for me was being able to, when I started, they actually talked to me about doing a singular Black Mirror. They said, do you want to come and look at an episode of Black Mirror? And I said, absolutely not. That would be really silly. And they were like, why? And I said, well, it's an anthology. And they went, okay. And I said, well, you've got to do everything. You know, if you don't do it all, you don't know how to balance each episode against the other to not, in simple terms, yeah, each episode could end up looking the same. So over time, I learned through, and I'm a firm believer of failure being the kind of bedrock, the foundation of any success. Anything good has got to sit on this kind of like mulch of and kind of solid ground that you've created over time of fails, so that you know what not to do when you do the right thing. And Nosedive was in a series of Black Mirrors. We went from three episodes on each first two seasons to six episodes in the next two seasons. And it gave me a broader understanding of how we were going to balance cold weather, hot weather, colors, temperature, feeling, future, dystopia. And so it was a very interesting thing because each one had to be identifiably its own film. And obviously, if they were handled by different people, having done all 19 up to seasons 1, 2, 3, and 4, I was able to move the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle around. Move the pieces of the chessboard or whatever. When it got very complicated, I could make decisions which meant each show balanced against the other. And with Nosedive, it wasn't about the future. It was actually about an alternative now. And initially, we were going to shoot that in LA as just LA. So the idea was it could just be now. But I was eager to make Nosedive, I think, a more enjoyable experience for the audience visually, so that when you got to the crux of the awfulness of it, you'd almost been just drawn in, lulled in, you'd fallen for it, you'd kind of gone with the story, and you'd fallen in love with the characters. And I think if it had been just contemporary when we started, you may not have had any sympathy for Lacey. And I think by making it something other, and making it softer and making her world and the world of people with enough points and enough money a pleasurable place to be, and then the world where money's not so good and you're not as popular, the world gets worse and darker and harder. And so, you know, that is another world. It's another world that we've just crawled into since we made this Black Mirror. We've crawled into that world at pace since making Nosedive. The world as apps became something like that. The world has shifted a bit and people started getting points for popularity, or you could get discounts if you're popular on things. So terrifyingly, Nosedive started dragging itself into a reality, but it was a flavor to let the audience enjoy the story, because it's so awful to just think of it as real if you watch it as a reality, that it was kind of a way of giving the audience a kind of a gentle way in to enjoy the story before the reality and the awfulness really sets in, you know.
And it seems like there's, I don't know, so many of these other science fictions, you're left fetishizing a lot of the design choices that someone like you would have made. Like Minority Report, it's hard to see through the elaborate nature of the gesture interface in order to just get at the heart of story, or even in the, you know, the constant heads up displays and visualizations of some kind of augmented reality that we see in Iron Man and the Avengers and you know, every other feature, or the massive kind of animated billboards on the skylines of Ghost in the Shell or Blade Runner 2049. But something like Crocodile here, where you're dealing with an exceptionally new device, this new piece of technology that can record people's memories and experiences in this way, it's almost retro as a design decision, and so it becomes so integrated in story in a way.
Well, again, so we work really hard, like going back to the first thing where we had a pebble. We called it the pebble, which you rewound your memories on entire history of you. And in Nosedive, we created a watch, a phone, an iPad. We had every device designed for Lacey so that if we needed to use them, we could, because we created a world of devices. And then I did an advert for those devices for us to look at them. So I actually branded Nosedive as an idea of what it would be like if it was a real world. And with Crocodile, we looked at a very... It's really simple. We wanted a device that looks not like something you'd buy off the shops, that you would be given if you worked in insurance or if you worked in a company. It's got a gaming quality to it. So there's an old gaming 80s game that Charlie used to play, and we looked at it and we were laughing and going, yeah, let's do something like that. And it's also got a kind of not microfiche, but it's got this distant lens factor, because memories are interpretive. And so what's important is you're not just looking at a screen and thinking, okay, it's telling me that that's the memories of everyone. You're looking into a lens that's got a kind of a layer of interpretation to the back projection of it. And that means that inside that box, when you look at that, it's not just a single front lens giving you information. Inside that box is interpreting those memories and giving them back to you. Because all memories, and it's a bit like when you do an insurance claim, if you have five people write what they saw, each person will have seen something different. And the insurance adjuster has to read all of those reports of witness statements to understand whether they can assess, as it were, whether what that person has written, those other four people had seen. And so this is kind of, this box had to feel like something that was in itself interpretive inside, not just giving you information like a screen. So there's a kind of interesting emotional attachment that you get to things. If they look vintage, retro, if they don't look easy, like they're purchasable products. Everything's, we spent a lot of time with every single device, making sure that it was never overplayed, but was either a product or very much not a product and all this kind of stuff. You know, like it had a very clear defining role, because all of these tech devices in Black Mirror are characters, are important characters in the story.
And it seems like you're, I don't know, quite uniquely positioned to explore that full range of design from like a very holistic approach, from initial concept art all the way through to props and prototyping, even graphic design, interface design, because of the founding of your studio painting practice, where you're not just a production designer, but with that studio, you're able to work all the way from concept art through pre-production and then actually into VFX and post-production as well. And perhaps that's part of the consistency and power of the Black Mirror design universe, when typically production designers, just in order to save money, aren't paid all the way through post-production. But at least in some of those early shows, you're able to keep a lot of the design process within your studio to create this sort of seamless world.
Yeah, the first two seasons were almost entirely done by painting practices. The VFX were done by painting practice, which meant that, and the motion graphics and the title sequence. So the music, the cracking, the mirror, the branding of Black Mirror. In fact, so it was what I personally believe in, and my business partner Dan May at painting practice, and the team. I have a team of people. We worked together for 15, 20 years. And it's all very, a very holistic view on how we approach everything. I left Black Mirror to do his Dark Materials. And interestingly, my experience on Black Mirror, it's very hard. Like you say, as a designer, I kind of transcended that. I was employing designers. I was in an advanced party often on Black Mirror. So right from day one, I was flying around the world looking for places to shoot, reading story ideas with Charlie and trying to help create the show. And so I've kind of journeyed into that a little bit more as I move into my future. Similar with Dark Materials, we're in post-production and pre-production, and I'm through all the VFX and the titles and everything. So it's basically a creative overview, much like what I did on Black Mirror. It was a hard one leaving Black Mirror after 8 years, I think it was. And after 19 shows, I think they've now made 22 or something. So they only made a few after. It's that holistic view. When I was first asked by them, do you want to do one episode? And I said, no, we have to do the whole. To brand a show, to understand a show, to understand an anthology and the journey of it. And there's a huge wealth, like I say, of errors and ideas which never made it to screen, which helped forge the things that did, basically. I can see you're bringing up all these interesting memories.
Yeah, we're just flicking through some slides produced from painting practice, your studio, as you know, pre-production work and various experiments into the design of a car or props, or even here, a concept painting for the look and feel of San Junipero.
That's the view of the hospital. Yeah, that was the view of the out the hospital window. We did the map paintings out the hospital window. And San Junipero was lovely. It was a really wonderful thing to find. And I flew to South Africa and in fact found an old cinema that had been turned into an ironworks, and it became Tucker's Bar. But that was just the exterior, and the beaches and everything were in South Africa. And interestingly on that, we used the Unreal Engine. We actually made virtual reality Tucker's Bar, which Charlie was amazed by, because I think we were trying to understand VR by that point internally, and using it as a tool to explore what we were going to shoot. And yeah, so that was great. But San Junipero was a very lovely, warm kind of memory of, and for me, going back to the 80s was great fun.
I mean, do you think this kind of studio is going to become increasingly the norm as production and visual effects starts to become such an extraordinary, critical storytelling device in contemporary cinema? Are we going to need studios like yours in order to keep that design language and that integrity of story running all the way through?
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what the. There's not many studios like Painting Practice, but then again, there's not. I'm a believer in the talent and the people, like I am the mistakes we make being the foundation. And so in our industry, a lot of people move on from people. They grow, they move, they change, they shift. And I've kind of forged ahead with a really small, not that small, but a really amazing group of talented people, Dan, Robin, all these people around me who are Erica, they're brilliant visionaries, graphic designers, artists, 3D designers. And as, like I say, after 15, 20 years, I think a lot of people don't have the interest in that kind of group. And I am a believer in those things because it gives you that ability to look at something very holistically, whereas a lot of people have to, by the time they've found the few people they need to help them with a project, there's only a bit of the project they can really do. So it's not the norm, Painting Practice, and or the team, like a team of people for 20 years. I think personally, I came from puppets. I came from Henson's. I worked there making things like, I worked on been on Babe and Neverending Story and the Flintstones. So I've always been involved in very weird things and love them. And so I'm always on the lookout for the next most complicated problem to engage in. And and it doesn't always mean the future, but the past is done. So interestingly, it rarely means the past, which is why the future often is something of interest.
Yeah, I mean, maybe we're at our time, but as a final question, maybe it's useful to just pick up on that notion of why the future is interesting, and in many ways, why stories like Black Mirror become meaningful and powerful in a way that documentaries might not be able to. And you mentioned The Twilight Zone, often, a show quoted when talking about Black Mirror. The reason I like to bring it up here is because its creator, Rod Serling, would use the camouflage of science fiction, UFOs, aliens, and monsters in order to reveal what he felt he couldn't say openly about society, or at least use it to create a critical subtext that would be accessible and visceral for audiences. So I wonder if you could talk a bit about why it is that such fictions, through connecting us emotionally with characters and perhaps then inciting us to against the systems that have done them wrong, why these stories have meaning, and especially why now we might look at Black Mirror and find a way of engaging with and coping with the present moment through these fictions that at the time were created without the foresight of the moment that we're in.
Well, I think that the Black Mirror world and Twilight Zone's always been a very, Charlie, myself, we all loved Twilight Zone, but the Black Mirror world, much like that, it is what it is. You are looking back at yourself in the reflection of a screen and the things you do and the horror we create and the journey, the path we're on with the things that are around us, the decisions we make. And it's and Black Mirror is very much just lifting up that that switched off phone to reflect back at us what we're up to, and which is why it resonates, I believe, and should never go too far beyond, because it's what the strength of the show is, which is to remind and reflect, remind us or show us or reflect back on us what we're up to. So, and I think Twilight Zone chose that medium, that fantastical medium, to terrify us or remind us of you know, how awful things can be, or, you know, weird. So in lots of ways, Black Mirror is, I'd like to think, generally does a kind of subtler and sometimes gentler view on nudging us. Sometimes it's not so subtle, but generally it kind of nudges us into a kind of waking up and looking at what's coming or looking at what we're up to.
Yeah, I mean, in my introduction, I talk about a lot of the technologies that Black Mirror engages with as before culture technologies, or that they kind of come at us before ideology or our capacity to understand what they mean. And in many ways, fiction becomes this space in which to prototype the possible implications of these emerging technologies, or to play out the multiple or unintended futures that they might set in motion. And it seems like it's an extraordinarily valuable design exercise, as well as being a great story.
But the future is, like I said, like I've said many times, in the Black Mirror world, the future's in that detail. So our futures, it was very interesting trying to say, well, I think the phones will get bigger, they'll get smaller, they'll get bigger, they'll get smaller. But look around, nothing's changed. Just those phones over 5-10 years got bigger and smaller and bigger and smaller, but not much else changed. And I think that I was asked to do a futurist talk with a group of people who are looking to design the world for older generations and all this kind of stuff. And asking, how did you picture what things would be like? And I was like, well, it's quite simple in some senses to look at what the future will be. But I do believe we're reaching a new era of the future. I think things are going to get very interesting. I think when I began the Black Mirror journey almost 10 years ago, things like 3D printing and organic 3D printing and stuff that can fix human beings as well as grow food and build buildings wasn't really on the cards as much. It was pure science fantasy, fiction, craziness. And that stuff in 10 years has got very real. And so I am very interested, if one was asked to picture a reality in 20 years now, what that would be. But as I say, I've left Black Mirror, so I won't be doing that for a bit.
Fair enough. Well, we watch on to see the next story. And all I can say is thank you so much for giving us the time tonight, but also for helping bring these extraordinary stories into the world. And I think they really do provide a valuable counterbalance to the prevailing media narratives around technology, where we're constantly sold these simple solutions that to extraordinary and complex problems. And in many ways, Black Mirror is the most visceral document of our live-action dystopian present. So thanks so much for walking us through it. Thanks so much for your time, and thanks so much for creating these worlds.
That's a pleasure.
Thanks, Joel.
And now we gather up what's left of our belongings and make a dash through the woods for the Canadian border. Behind us, the bodies sway from ropes along the river, and the last group of fertile women left in America hike up their red ceremonial gowns to do their godly duty. As we are bundled into the back of a van and electrified with a cattle rod, Anne Crabtree takes us through the ways of A Handmaid's Tale. Anne is a costume designer for film and television. In recent years, she has become the costumer for Dystopia, dressing the characters of Westworld and The Handmaid's Tale. In these troubled lands, her clothes reflect the political power structures at play in the world she is designing for. Her iconic red gown and white cowl has now marched off the screen and holds the lines at protests around the world, the perfect costume for a reality that is stranger than fiction.
Start back on the series that she was designing before COVID-19. To everyone watching, please post your questions in the chat and we'll try and weave them into the conversation. And thanks so much for joining us from your bubble.
Yes, thanks for having me. I loved hearing the other two artists, I'm going to call them, speak. And yeah, it was really heady. And it's interesting to be in this bubble of Williamsburg, where you can sort of look into everyone's real dystopian reality. My own included. Thanks for having me.
A pleasure. So we're going to start here with this red gown and white cowl that you designed, the icons of the Handmaid's Tale series. And I want to talk about the ways a costume designer thinks about world building. But let's start with a trailer from season one of Handmaid's Tale, just to remind us of the worlds of Atwood's Gilead.
I was asleep before. That's how we let it happen. When they slaughtered Congress, we didn't wake up. When they blamed terrorists and suspended the Constitution, we didn't wake up then either. Now I'm awake. My name is Offred. I had another name.
Ladies, I have to let you go. It's the law now.
They needed to do it this way. All the bank accounts and the jobs all at the same time. Can you imagine the airports otherwise?
Run, run, run!
No, please don't take her! No!
You girls will serve the leaders and their barren wives. You will bear children for them.
An eye in your house.
We'll send you to the colonies. You'll be cleaning up toxic waste and then you'll die.
Tonight is a celebration of Gilead and of what we have achieved.
We only wanted to make the world better.
Better?
Better never means better for everyone.
We want to keep on living for her.
Remember your scripture. Blessed are the meek.
And blessed are those who suffer for the cause of righteousness.
So in many ways, the gown and cowl is an object that encapsulates the world of Gilead. In miniature, it's almost a microcosm of this universe of The Handmaid's Tale. I wanted to start with you taking us a little bit through the process that you used to create this piece and how the narrative of the world around it shapes its design.
Right. So we had a giant among writers and amongst dystopia and the reality of politics, Miss Margaret Atwood, to look to for inspiration. And it's pretty daunting to try to visualize and create what I thought her words meant. And her words meant quite a lot to me. then it moved on to Bruce Miller. You know, anytime you start any project, you are combing through, you're reading a script once to get a feel and flow of the universe at hand, but you read it a second and third time to see what are the nuances that are hidden between the words. And certainly The Handmaid's Tale has been done so many times prior. It's been a film that I loved in 1990, and it was a book that I loved in 85, and it's been on Broadway. It's had every form of presentation since its unearthing in 85. So I really didn't want to do anything that was done before. And quite frankly, I tried to pitch a crazy idea that I thought would be a true dystopia moment, saying instead of the white bonnets or wings as they're called, or cowls as you call them, and capes, I said, hey, what we should really do is think on the landfill fills of everywhere across the world and how polyester is the only thing that's left. And so in my mind, in my first 2 hour interview with Bruce Miller and Warren Littlefield, I pitched this whole idea, which would look nothing like this. It would look like a melting pot of really bright colors that were left over that will never go anywhere in the soil, and a whole new Gilead making those clothes. Of course, that would look crazy given the tone of the show. And so the images that you have in front of you are what I created. Some of that came, you know, I always start with history because that's what we remember. That's what is there reference-wise. And I didn't want it to look old. I didn't want it to look like history. I wanted everything to look like something terrifying that would happen today. And here we are. So many things are happening today in politics, but for costumes in a fictitious story, you know, what I tried to do was I took everything that was pertinent to the story and history, and I really simplified it all. The gentleman before me was talking about, you know, mid-century. I went back in time to certain design moments that felt quite like no time and every time. And that would be in clothing, the 1900s. This is just my take on what is every time. The 1930s, the 1960s, the very beginnings of time in here, and even the 1990s. So that was the start. And then in between, Liam, was a million different cultures and things from nature and very strange influences from my childhood growing up here in the States and Kentucky.
Yeah, because the Handmaid's Tale is not a period show in any form. Wow. It's not really a future, nor a present, nor a past in a way. It's a world that you could emerge, that could emerge at any moment. And in a way, it's the fact that you're drawing these reference points from all over the map that means it's kind of impossible to place it. And you've talked about bringing influences from artists like Matthew Barney, or even inspiration from Blade Runner, and also these different chronological reference points in fashion. And you talk a bit about the beginning of every decade as being your touchstone or reference point, because it is the essence of that time. We see the fashion as the essence of that moment. And in a way, that's part of the timeless nature of the show. Is that part of where you started?
It is where I started. You say it much better than I do, Liam. I think that, you know, my process is slightly crazy to some and really normal to others. I have a barrage of images that come while sleeping, while actually working, and they go everywhere around the office where I'm working so that I can work it out. And also so that I don't see anything else when I'm creating a show. And for this one, I really drew on religion. Even part of the Handmaid's front of the dress came from a priest in Italy. You know, the wings came ostensibly from things that had happened in the show, but really came from a drawing in the New Yorker that Bruce Miller loved in, I can't remember what year, probably the 90s. And from there, what you do is you take what has gone before and then you put your spin on it. For me, I knew I wanted a kind of insular world around their faces so that I could, the whole design is actually based on control, controlling of women. And it's something that many of us hear every day. And so I just applied it into my design, controlling the head space of women, metaphorically and realistically, politically, emotionally, and also creating a kind of light box that frames their faces, these faces that have no makeup, and hides them from the side so that when you see them marching through Gilead or being marched in front of like that with Aunt Lydia, there's no way to distinguish the individual. And so all individuality has been taken away. They're walking wombs of red that shows their fertility. Everything about this costume was how to control not just the individual actor, the individual character, but to also how to control a large swath of an environment. And really that came from stepping up and designing from the point of a commander in charge. And I thought about all the little things that were a part of Gilead. In essence, if I were a commander, the world that I created, I would want everything to be really lean because I wouldn't want to waste money. The world is in turmoil. How do we even make fabric? You know, everything was essential to the reality of how we were going to make these costumes. So in the end, I made a mini factory in my space in Toronto where we dyed things the old-fashioned way, where we built those wings the old-fashioned way. And it became, you know, part of the story. It became a character. This, what you're seeing, this uniform of Handmaid's actually reveals the morals and the everyday living and working in Gilead. People make these costumes. So this is how we approached it.
Yeah, and you spoke a bit about even elements like the waistline, for instance, as being a window into the womb and revealing the whether a woman was pregnant or not. Can you talk about some more of those little details? I think they're fascinating as miniatures of this larger world as I was describing.
Right. So everything is in an extreme wide and an extreme intimate close-up in at least the first two seasons of The Handmaid's Tale. And within that, I tried to think of little ways that were very quiet in the frame of kind of little examples of someone controlling. And so one of those ways, yes, was this obi that I designed around the waist because these handmaids are treated like chattel. You know, they are even like cattle and they are, you know, the only fertile women left. So all that ostensibly the commanders in charge are thinking about is how to create progeny, how to have babies in a world where fertility is way down. Oddly, it reflects the world today. But part of that is creating a kind of belt or harness around the very area that grows when a woman is pregnant. And so she can no longer wear that obi when she's pregnant. It has to go away. And that is one way in a sea of handmaids that the commanders are able to say, okay, that one is pregnant, that one. And to control that, those 9 months are really the entire lifetime of a handmaid. There's also within Aunt Lydia, you know, or even with Joe Fiennes here, there are braces, you know, remnants of the past that speak to being a gentleman, but also I try to give a little sort of evangelical leader to this Joe Fiennes character. And it was braces, it was a vest, it was a strange pseudo-military symbols as roping and stars on his jackets. But oddly, I looked to influences that were not really militaristic at all. I looked to religion or culture, like Shintoism. I also threw in fashion elements of a time, for instance, in this dress. It's from the 60s. The color is really powerful and rooted to the frame. It's very poignant, this blue, and the exact opposite of red, right? It's cold, it's someone from the matriarchy, it's political, it's supposedly soothing, which is not the typical vibe or view of Serena Joy, but it's a woman in power, and it's also quite Catholic, which I didn't really think about until after I designed it. But I was really looking for a component that was opposite the deep blood red that would resonate on the screen, and it was this blue.
Mm. And you mentioned this row of three pleats that we're seeing on the screen, and you mentioned somehow the costumes being Catholic in a form. Tell us about this reoccurring motif of these three pleats, because we're going to see them again a little later in the tops of the lab costumes in Westworld as well. It's a recurring thing for you in many ways.
It's so funny. So three is really important to me, just in general. And I am very superstitious. And I kept, when I first arrived in Canada, I kept waking up at 3:33, 3 a.m. This only happened once before at an artist residency, and it became this really incredible creative moment, much like the time in Canada for this show. When I started waking up at 3:33 every morning, and oddly, my body was turning around 360 degrees, and I don't usually move in my sleep. I took it as a notion of, again, high creative energy coming in. And also in Kentucky, where I'm from in the South, it's very biblical. When someone told me it was, you know, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, I was like, okay, thank you. I don't use it as that. I use it as a highly spiritual time when creative impulse is coming in. And so I just kept using it. But the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost felt quite Gilead in a way, because these were very, you know, religious right people taking over America, destroying it and creating it in the perfect form in their mind's eye of a religious community, much like it happens every day. Aunt Lydia here, there's military and religion happening constantly in the show. This uniform is fabric that was made, is still made today for Canadian military. It also is quite like the uniforms of World War II. It reminded me of images in Nazi Germany, and certainly Miss Atwood definitely saw that when she tried on her uniform when she became an aunt in the first episode. I've created a little, so there's little things like this little closure of the belt, which feels a bit like bondage and a bit like a cross turned on its side. You know, a kind of caution, do not cross, because I doubt that any of the aunts are having sex, or maybe one or two, but certainly not Aunt Lydia. There is a female shape of a woman's vagina around her neck, which came from one of the first exhibitions that I saw revolving around feminism when I was quite young as an art student. And I thought, my God, here's a whole story of women's fertility, women's body parts being celebrated as opposed to being hidden. So I put that tiny feminist idea around the very part that you always see in TV land, which is right here. And it's Aunt Lydia's kind of protection against the patriarchy, in my mind. That's why I created it. And it's also a very modern idea, this idea of a dickie. How do you change a military uniform when you have limited means? You don't care about women, so you're not trying to give them lots of clothing. And, you know, how to give them layers for warmth. That is a woolen dickie. That is a woman's vagina. It's many things, but it's rooted in symbolism all the way around.
Yeah, I mean, your design choices are so much about discomfort and the exercise of power in a way. And I know you talked a bit about projecting yourself into the role of the commander to try and understand what it would mean to think through the design of garments that would exercise that power over women. And I know that you struggled with that role a little bit, and you created little secrets in some of the costumes for the actors, things that would be pleasing to you almost as a coping strategy and a cathartic exercise to get through this moment of trying to design these horrible garments of oppression.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly not anything I believe in personally. on the contrary, I think so much of what designers dream up comes from monsters, real or unreal, that we experienced growing up. And certainly a lot of that hardcore religion and conservatism of Gilead, I was reminded of, you know, from Kentucky. And so that was a really good place to call this incredible discomfort. You know, I always think, and maybe this is detrimental to my process, I always think if I'm a little uncomfortable in the dreaming of it, it must mean something more than just a beautiful anything. And I tend to design with the idea of pretty and ugly. And by that, I mean cinematically beautiful and quite repulsive. And if I can bring both of those psychological things in, generally speaking, I feel a lot better. Generally speaking, it makes sense to the story. So yeah, every night after designing, I would have this kind of self-loathing, sort of like, what am I doing to the women characters? And even in real time, what am I doing to constrict these women? And in fact, put violence on the actors, you know, through the day. Oddly, most of them, I think actually all of them told me, the men included, that it really helped them to immediately get into character in their dressing room. So that's a horrible thing that ended up being beautiful on camera.
there's a question from the chat.
Okay.
About the burqa debates and wondering in this context, yeah, if that was a reference, if that was something you were thinking about or connecting into that very real discourse about the control and visibility of a woman's body through fashion.
You know, it's very interesting. I have gotten this in varying degrees in positive and negative ways when I was touring the country. And many women, you know, Muslim women, you know, in happy ways and not happy ways, were talking with me about it, saying, oh my God, you got it dead on, you know, or why did you choose us, you know, as your muse? I actually didn't use the burqa as a muse. What's weird about me, and it's probably from a kind of fucked up childhood, is that this is the most hair I've had in years. I'm usually bald. I haven't had long hair in 10 years because of a long story, but I also find it really sexual, and I find it to be sort of an easy way that women are beautiful. And so maybe I've got a weird idea about hair. Also, because it's so thick, I've always covered my hair with a scarf. Martha, the main Martha, is her scarf is made from my scarf. And I love, if you look at the girls in pink, the children, in the background. I've covered their hair because the story requires it. It's about religion. We always cover, tend to, in many different cultures, Judaism, even in Japan, when women get married, I can't think of all the moments, but we cover women's hair. And so for me, what that did is I was following a dogma that is a real thing, but I was also taking advantage of an idea to hide hair to really concentrate on the emotions of the handmaids and everyone. Even I was sort of the hair ninja saying, you cannot make pretty hair in Gilead. It wouldn't happen, you know, and they made fun of me, but you know, they said, Anne was like the dogma Gilead queen, because I wanted it to be so real that we couldn't make mistakes. And so it comes from my own, it does not come from the burqa, which maybe it's very politically, incorrect to say, but I find it to be beautiful when a woman chooses it for her own strength, pride, and protection. I see it in two different ways and not in my costumes.
And we've spoken about the timelessness nature of Handmaid's Tale, drawing from all these different period references. If we take a slight detour now into the worlds of season one in Westworld, here it's a different kind of animal where you're designing for a definitive future centered around a new relationship to the emerging technologies of artificial intelligence or biotech. I wonder what are the reference points you begin to design with these pieces for an imagined tomorrow, and is that process different to the one we've been describing with Handmaid's Tale? Or is it the same in that even these futures are rooted in a relationship to your reference deck and your extraordinary walls of notes and image references?
You know what? I really believe that, and especially after 30 years, it's so boring. My process is the same every time, and I wish I could change it. But the approach to designing is always the same, no matter the story. And then once I have the story in my brain, certainly, this season one of Westworld was, design-wise, it was the Wild West of perhaps the 1850s, because that was the most visual, to be honest, for myself and Jonah Nolan and Lisa Joy. And then it was the future, sometime in the future. We were always trying to be vague about when that was. Sometimes we would smile and say, maybe it's 2040, which is not even that far away now. Is the process different? Yes, because Gilead, Handmaid's Tale, is based on being a world that goes back. It's the future, but it goes back to organic growing of things, weaving your own cloth, dyeing it with natural fibers, going back to the past because the future is so ugly to whomever is in charge. Whereas Westworld is Michael Crichton, a brilliant mind, a man who was so far ahead of his time and past ahead of his time. Also, I was 9 when this came out, and I watched it over and over and over and fell in love with it. This is an embracing of the future, an embracing of, rubberized garments, because you're working on AI that have flesh and blood and organs and those things and skin, visors, which look very much like something I had to wear on the plane yesterday with a mask. I was fully covered. And rubber gloves. Like, yes, this is what we're wearing now. And people are now, as you so elegantly talked about terraforming one day, Liam, people are now terraforming their idea of covering for protection, and they're trying to get cute with it, right? Like different patterns and weird glasses. And it's interesting how humans adapt to shackles. that are put on us, whether it's via health or, you know, society. Westworld was a world with a lot of white and red, oddly, now I'm seeing it, which is so weird, in the future. And it was a world that was controlled by AI. And so AI, I think about a world where AI is in charge, AI is going to view garments, things that make up garments quite differently, right, than a human, even if they've programmed them. And so, yes, that part of the process, that part of the thinking is unusual. Yeah. And really, what I was, and if you want to know, you probably want to know, instead of talking loftily, the research for this was thinking ahead, thinking, you know, no buttons, no zippers in the future. At one time, we even talked about garments that were neither male nor female, but it just gets so complicated. Everything gets complicated on a TV timeline and time frame. And so you don't have time to actually sit and ponder. You have to move with your gut 24/7. And so I think we thought these were the choices that made sense with a dual story, a story from the romanticism of the past of the 1850s and wanting that again as a guest living in a 2040 world where everything is controlled.
Yeah, and as we start to move into the conclusion of the conversation, I want to re-invite the audience to ask any more questions that you have for Anne, and please drop it on the chat. But for me, what I want to talk about now is just to call back to the ways that Westworld, and as you described, seems to be enacting and visualizing a strange present moment where there are these extraordinary forms of PPE, and it is this strange, very prescient prediction. And in a way, that's what's happening with Handmaid's Tale as well, that dystopias are so readily becoming documentaries. And the Handmaid's Tale, of course, originally premiered to coincide, not deliberately, but coincidentally, with the emergence of the Me Too movement. And when we first spoke about The Handmaid's Tale together, it was in LA, just around the time that all the stories around Harvey Weinstein were emerging, and that critical resonance these types of stories have with the present moment seemed to reappear over and over again. And of course, this is my segue now into the conversation that's happening, where the costumes from Handmaid's Tale have now left the screen and have leapt onto the front lines of protests around the world. And when you see some of these cautionary tales of dystopia come true, when we see the imagery of women in their own Handmaid's costumes fighting to be heard, I wonder just how chilling that must be for you. Chilling that the contemporary world is approaching Gilead, that these parallels are so easily drawn, that we live in a world where the one thing a woman can do is to wear such a cloak from these fictions to make a point about the contemporary control of their bodies. What do you feel when you see images like this constantly being bombarded on the screen to it?
It's funny because I pulled up my own, right, just to remind myself of all the countries, you know, protesting for, you know, birth control and abortion rights. And this one is so chilling because her face is obscured and says, this is how it starts. Wow. It gets me every time, Liam. You know, I never am tired or jaded looking at these images. And in all honesty, it's really moved past the realm of my own giving birth to something. It was always Margaret Atwood's story. And certainly this image was born in her writing. I just had my, you know, 2016, 2017 spin on things. oddly, right when, yes, Trump was elected, and oddly, we've seen the fallout, everything that's happened. How does it feel? It feels really sad and slightly exhilarating, which is really twisted, I know, but it makes me understand that the power is with the artist. The power is with the pen. The power is with the DP filming, and it's so important to keep creating something that means something to you. My whole real life is tied up in these images, with Planned Parenthood, with protests, it's shattering because they're talking about reproductive rights, you know, wearing this. This is a story that was fiction, began long ago in 85, and we're still fighting the same fight. And so I say that with pride. And when I'm an old lady, I'll feel like, wow, I took something that was discordant in my brain that needed to be heard visually. But beyond that, way beyond that moment for me, is artists are the ones who tell and foretell what's happening in our society. Thank God. And thank God I'm able to do that for a living and have therapy myself in the creating and co-creating of any of that pauses, those moments that are pauses throughout history.
A question from the chat, and not unrelated, is what is the most challenging part of creating these costumes for you? Is it that conceptual mindset to get into this space to start to tell these stories? Is it a technical question and a pragmatic one?
I mean, it's okay, and that's a really great question to whoever's asking that. You know, for me, it's all of those things. But truly, the hardest part of any creating of any costume is, how do I tell the truth? How do I tell the truth? How do I tell the story that's being told? And if I don't believe something in the lines of what I've done, then I'm lying. And I'm just dialing something in. And so that's the part that makes me tear my hair out. You know, if I can't find the truth and the respect to the story that is its due, then I'm not doing my job. And it doesn't have to be big. It sometimes needs to be really quiet. This happens to be bright red, but it packs a punch, I think, because the details are quiet, intimate, and relate to every woman, hopefully.
Hmm. And another question from the chat. Can you talk a little bit about the work that hasn't been released yet? What are you working on? What are you excited about? Perhaps you can't talk about why you're in New York and the show that you're on, but maybe there's another project that you're working on that would be possible to hint at.
I can do that without naming anything and without being specific. When you put that first image of the protest picture up, it kind of throttled me because that this is how it starts. The day that we shut down, I'll never forget, March 12th, just a few months ago. That's the last time I was working on this project that I won't name. We were shooting a scene under a tent filled with sick people in protective gear. March. Before, there were rumblings, you know, in February when I was in London about Italy. Something's happening in Italy and something's happening in Japan. And it's a Chinese virus, by the way. It's just Chinese. All of these untruths. And the fact that we were so prescient, you know, it was really chilling. And even that day, the National Guard was called into upstate New York. And we had National Guard, not fake ones, we use real ones, but we had them on set as a part of the scene, corralling people. And it really took me back to that moment, this photograph. This is how it starts. You know, we're just vessels who are, of course, it's all hard work and it's all hard thought. And it's really difficult to to think on how to make something. For me, what I try to do in my design is make everything of this very moment, no time. I like to live my life in no time. And for instance, right now we're on 4 time zones, as you said last night. My work should be something that could be a documentary. It could be the news. It could be on television. But I want everyone to either A, be terrified and afraid of what could be. I want people to care about what could be and what is right now. And I want it to go into you. I want it to go under your skin so that you look twice. So it's not just, oh, what a beautiful portrait of New York in the 1900s, you know? And so that happened and has been happening in my work. Also, what I want to say is I've driven across the country twice now in between New York and Los Angeles and London and Morocco, and to see different worlds responding to life, politics, art, our worlds that we're inhabiting, it's really helpful to me in my work. And certainly to see, you know, what was happening in the Navajo Nation with COVID has really gone in there. And I will use that big moment in history as a time which speaks to prior history in America and is happening today. All these things are things for inspiration, because we have to be positive about continuing as a species and as creative. So the show I'm on now will be very much speaking to what's happening now.
And one of the unexpected opportunities presented by this moment was also the chance for us to work together. And you've spent the last few months designing an entirely different future world, in this case, an attempt between us to collaborate on what is hopefully will be a positive and optimistic vision of a future city.
Yeah, Liam, you healed me. And maybe you broke me. Because as I've been known as the woman who builds dystopian worlds, I have to say I had to check myself a few times in our dealings. Thankfully, you brought this to me in March, because I could have just been in a fetal position watching the news, you know, like many. But yeah, you said, let's think on a utopia instead of a dystopia. Let's think on a world where we all came together and tried to heal the earth. I mean, that is huge and hopefully not untouchable. You know, hopefully that can be our reality. It's really been such a thing to switch, you know, the toggle and make myself understand that utopia is what we start out with. And I feel like I've done so much dystopia that I'm ready for the utopia. Thank you, Liam. Sincerely.
Well, that film, thank you for all of your work on that. And audiences watching can see that film at the end of the year in December.
Yeah.
But in the meantime, I mean, and who knows what reality that project will be birthed into. But for now, that the every day of Handmaid's Tale has almost become the ready-to-wear for a dystopia already here, is perhaps not a turn even the most pessimistic amongst us could have imagined. And to conclude, in a sinister foreshadowing of what might to come, what might be coming, Gilead, the drug company, not the setting for Handmaid's Tale, is the owner of the only antiviral drug currently authorized to treat COVID-19.
Yeah. Which so unfortunately, in February, someone did predict that, and they were right.
So unfortunately, we may not be approaching season's end, and the horrors of 2020 may yet be renewed. But thank you so much, Anne, for making this work, and for joining us today. And please keep telling these stories for as long as they're necessary.
All right.
Thanks again.
It's been a pleasure. Thanks, Strelka. Thanks, everybody. watching. Thanks, Liam.
Thanks so much.
All right. Take care.
And so, as our journey through the ruins of the future ends, we thank our guests and fellow travelers. It was a pleasure to ride with you all. The In Other Worlds series is a call to arms. It's a hope that we may all keep making stories and building worlds that become vessels for critical ideas, Trojan horses hidden within the mediums of popular culture. So many of our dystopian visions have come true this year, and still perhaps so many are yet to come. The aliens haven't invaded, the machine uprising is still a long way off, and the slow catastrophe of climate change rumbles on in our blind spot. But then again, it's still only August, of course, and 2012 may not be done with us yet. The world has ended three times in the last 6 months, and now we sit and wait for it to break again. So with that in mind, for the next edition of In Other Worlds, we will retreat from this earthly land and blast off for Planet B to explore the remote worlds of outer space. So on August 25th, we'll be joined by the production designer of Arrival and the forthcoming Dune. We will meet the concept illustrator of Mandalorian and the writer of this year's best game winner, The Outer Wilds. Rather than distracting us with false narratives of escape, can these stories of remote worlds afford us a critical distance from which we may be able to reevaluate ourselves? Across the past 2 hours of Other Worlds, Jeff Bezos made $18 million and 500 people died from the coronavirus and 133 million people swiped on Tinder. See you after the end of the world.
Thank you so much, Liam, Joel, Mike, and Anne, for this amazing talks and for your great work. It was really special and inspiring to hear about it directly from the creators. Tonight's event will stay online on our YouTube and all Strelka social media platforms. So please follow us there and check for updates at strelka.com. We just announced day 2 of Another World series, so don't miss it. It will be happening on August 25. Thank you everybody for watching us tonight, and bye.